Have you ever wondered why some people live longer than other people? While they seem to have more glow, they're more limber, they're more active, they just seem to have more fervor. Well, there are great reasons for this, and I know exactly why. Today I'm talking 5 tips that you can do easily, inexpensively, at home. Make these part of your habits that you can do at 50 and beyond to make you look and most importantly feel better for the next 50 years. Now these are things that I learn in my clinic from my patients. I have a database and I see over 10,000 patients from my database, and when they come see me, I'm of course looking at their skin, at their glow, but of course we're talking about their wellness, how they feel as well. They're interconnected. And when I see someone looking great and they say they're feeling great, I say, what did you change? And everyone's always changing something, so I learn, and I'm presenting these tips to you today. Number one is water. Now it sounds real simple. With each of these tips, I'm going to tell you exactly how and what to do. With water, what are you going to do? Number one, you're going to keep it by your bedside. An 8 ounce glass of water overnight. When you wake up, you're going to drink it. And it's as simple as that, because your skin needs hydration for glow. Your body needs hydration for your kidneys to filter out waste products. And overall, the brain and circulation, of course, depends on water. A lot of the components of your body are made up of water. So start your morning with that. Now here's one thing you don't want to have by your bed. Some people do. They have a coffee by their bed. Why is that wrong? Because your cortisol is high in the morning. Give your cortisol about an hour to balance it out. When you wake up, you're going to see light, photons hitting the back of your eye. You're going to have your serotonin climb, your cortisol level out, you have your water on board from that tip. And then 40 minutes to 1 hour after you wake up, you're going to drink your coffee if you're a coffee drinker. I have a whole video on the benefits of coffee that I'll link at the end of this video, but water is a key important tip. Number two is intermittent fasting. Now you hear a lot of things, do fast, don't fast, fast for 24 hours, 12 hours is enough. What I've learned in practice, what I practice myself and what my patients tell me, most people 3 times a week will fast. That does seem to be enough, and that's a 15-hour fast. So when you wake up, you fast, you have a mid-afternoon lunch, an early supper, and that gets you into what we call autophagy, where the body can clean its own cellular debris and get rid of some waste products naturally. So intermittent fasting 3 times a week for about that time period seems to provide a lot of benefits to my patients for their energy, for their well-being, and for the systems of their body to work. Of key importance, when you are eating, please eat real food. Take farmed salmon as an example. I have a whole video on that. Non-organic meats, non-organic vegetables, GMO foods. You want to eliminate those from your diet. Eat real organic foods. Try and find a local farmer and wash all your vegetables thoroughly, even if it says they're washed on them. Pesticides are wreaking havoc with our xenoestrogens. So these are fake estrogens that bind the receptors, and they're changing our children, but also ourselves. And hormones after the age of 50 are key. I have a very key video, definitely I will at the end of this video link, because it's all on hormone replacement therapy. And we have a big problem in this country and many countries around the world as they westernize. Hormones are key. You want to watch that video. Intermittent fasting and autophagy are a key part of the routine of patients in my practice who look and feel better than most. Number three is exercise. Now, not just any exercise, but it's been studied that there are 3 specific ones you want to think of.
These 3 specific exercises help with hormones, with bone loss, with endorphins and serotonin.
Hormones, very key, and helps balance them. Number one, testosterone levels. Now, testosterone is very important in building muscle. That's what supports your bones and tissue repair. When you don't repair tissue, you feel drug out, you feel tired. And your tissue repair, of course, includes skin. And when you look better, you feel better. Second thing, think endorphins. So think serotonin as an example of a neurotransmitter that helps with your mood. Your overall mood makes you feel better. And again, when you feel better, you're more motivated, you get more things done, you make more money. All those things lead to a feeling of well-being and a better life. Growth hormone increases. Again, think tissue repair and think muscle building. And when you do those things, you get an improvement in your testosterone and even your estrogen. Number one, deadlifts. Number two, the squat. And number three, the shoulder press. Now, you know the graph I show a lot about the estrogen decline. When you get estrogen loss, you get thinning of the skin.
On this graph, and I've included men here, of course, I want to be balanced. If you look at the females, they're in kind of the maroon colored, the purple color, and there's a 3% decline per year. Look at menopause. It decreases by 20%. You think hormones aren't important? Yes, they're absolutely key. As the skin thins, the wrinkles increase. And we haven't even talked about fat pads yet.
And a plethora, a whole textbook of other problems go along with lowering your estrogen than just your skin, but also other hormone balances, your thyroid, and of course, your energy, your sleep, your mood, hot flashes, everything. So exercise plays an absolutely vital role and definitely makes it into the top five. If you're not doing it, watch my complete video. I'll put a link up here and at the end of the video on the single best exercise for women. And it goes through a study, the Lifmore trial. In particular, in that study, it talks about improving your bone mass. And of course, loss of facial bone is one key feature that ages us, especially women, after the age of 40. Next is exfoliation.
Not just any type of exfoliation, however.
A lot of times we have dead skin cells, we have brown spots, we have photoaging, and we lose glow after the age of 50. To rejuvenate it, you want to help unglue the stuck down skin cells, reduce sunspots, shrink pores, because as we age over time, pores don't open and close. That's not what they do, but they get larger looking because they get quote unquote clogged up. What specific thing do you want to do for exfoliation? I have videos on physical exfoliation like shaving, like microblading, but chemical exfoliation with wet pads. This is an example. This is Evenglow exfoliation pads. Pads like these have not only glycolic, which you'll know from chemical peels, they also have salicylic acid, which is fat soluble, gets into the pores and helps remove the sebum and everything clogging that pore so you get a more even skin tone. And there's lactic acid as well as other fruit extracts like grapefruit that help exfoliate the skin, decrease melanin or brown spot production, and even remove existing brown spots. Why I like those, it's stable, that might last you a year or two, it's inexpensive, and you can use as part of your weekly routine, or you can use them as peel pads. I have complete videos on how to do that so that you don't have to go into your clinic to get exfoliation, deep peels, or other products or facials, and it can be done inexpensively like that at home. But exfoliation, no question, one of the keys to looking younger. The last series of things that you need to think about, you're not 20 anymore. You're now 50, 55 plus, whatever it is, you have to take care of your own healthcare. No one else is doing it for you. Most primary care physicians and providers are mere secretaries now, and they're doing what's coming on the computer for general screening guidelines. Well, guess what? You're not general. You're unique. You have your own family history instead of health issues, family history of problems, and set of unique circumstances where you need to consider six tests that I'm going to talk about today. Number one, Now, I have videos on all of these individually, so I'm not going to go into details, but I'm going to list them. If you want to know details or detailed video, I'll try and link as many as I can. But if you go to Google or YouTube, you can certainly search Rajani and the test, and my complete video will come up. But number one is colonoscopy screening. Now, depending on your family history, it's going to be earlier than 40 or after 50. The thing is here, most people are getting it way too late. We're losing younger and younger people to colon cancer. And there's many different ways of screening. I go into my videos. It's one to think about. Number two, mammography. So 1 in 8 women are going to get breast cancer. Again, depending on family history, your own unique set of circumstances, you may need to start it before 40 or after 50, depending on the guidelines. But again, we're starting this way too late. You want to think about low-level radiation screening. Some people go straight to MRI. Figuring out what is important and works for you is key. The key here is addressing it and discussing it, and you're going to have to research some of this on your own. Number three is to assess your bone density. And again, we're doing it too late. By the time you see that you have low bone density, so many people are getting it after the age of 65, it's too late. You want to prevent. The reason you want to get these tests is to prevent it. So if you see a slight lower bone density, you can address it with many things, including diet. There are certain medications you can go on, and things like K2-D3, supplements that help put calcium into the bone. So think about bone density DEXA screening. It's commonplace, but we're doing it too late. Number four, think about a blood test for vitamin D levels. Many of you are living in parts of the country you're not getting much vitamin D, but it plays a role in many, many things, including immunity and, of course, your bone density and your overall well-being. Vitamin D levels are simple, they're easy, they're inexpensive. Very few people will talk to you about getting them, but I think they're worth doing. Next is hormone levels. Don't guess, but one good screening is, as a female, ask your mom when she had menopause, when her hormones changed. There is a genetic component to this. So if she says, oh, it's getting hot flashes at 35, you need to know, you need to get tested. But if you're getting signs of perimenopause or menopause, know your levels, because of course your hormones play a role in everything. I have videos on a complete video actually on hormone replacement therapy. It's about 50 minutes, 50. It's a well worth watch. I think every woman should watch that. I put a lot of time into that. Your bones, your regulator of your mindset, your energy, your sleep, hot flashes, well-being, all depends on your hormone levels. Why guess? Simply measure them. We have the technology. It's inexpensive. I want you to think about a cardiac calcium CT scan. It's a quick CT scan. I actually had mine about a week ago, and I reversed mine from the results that I had 10 years ago. I did a 10-year follow-up, and in fact, my heart got better. I reversed the calcium in my heart. If you want me to make a complete video on that, I'm happy to share that with you. I run a high cholesterol. I didn't want to have to make a lot of changes in my diet or activity levels, so I got the heart tested. Mine was $220. You can find them for $99. Sometimes they're offered free in certain communities. It's a very quick, low radiation CT scan. Boom, they take the picture, you get your score. So that cardiac calcium score gives you an idea what's going on in the blood vessels to your heart. The blood needs oxygen. Your heart's beating all the time, whether you know it or not. When you're sleeping, eating, drinking, upright, you don't think about it. Your heart's beating. It needs oxygen to function. When it doesn't get oxygen, that's called a heart attack, and you get death of yourself or death of a portion of your heart. None of it's good. And as the number one killer, if you can remove that variable from your life and say, well, I have a low or a higher risk of heart disease, you can make changes with your diet, your exercise, and your medications to prevent what is the number one cause of death for men and women. So it makes a lot of sense to scan that and study it rather than guess, especially if you're a smoker, have family history, or hormonal changes, all those things that lead to more plaque in the heart, high cholesterol in my case. I was quite nervous. I thought for sure I was going to, as most people do, the calcium score increases. So good news on that, but I want to share with you what I did and how I did it, if that's something you're even interested in. I know it's a little more removed. We're talking about heart health and wellness and journey, but it is something I do and talk about every day in my clinic to my patients. Now, it's extremely important for your journey to watch these videos. Number one, one on bioidentical hormone replacement, one down here on autophagy and intermittent fasting, and one up here on the single most important exercise that you can do to keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant. Enjoy your journey.